O most merciful Father, we come before Thee once again this evening, O God. We thank Thee for the beginning of this week, O Lord. O God, we ask that the word that we heard expounded, the sacraments in which we partook, the songs we sang, the psalms that we prayed back to Thee, O God, on Sunday, on the Lord's Day, would be still vibrant in our minds, O God. Thou would still build us up in the means of grace that we partook. Lord, we thank Thee for Thy providence this week. We thank Thee for Thy hand to guide us and govern us, O Lord. And it is to Thee that we commit ourselves. We thank Thee for the opportunity to once again gather, to open Thy Word, to study spiritual things, O God, and to grow in our faith together. Lord, we pray for the magistrates of our city, our state, and our nation, O God. Please grant them wisdom. Please grant repentance where needed, O Lord. Please help them to govern according to Thy law, that it might fall out according to Thy will in a way that is good for Thy people, that Thy church might serve Thee peaceably and in ease, O Lord. Lord, we thank Thee for Thy mercies and Thy kindness to us in Thy Son, Jesus Christ. We thank Thee for the salvation that we have been given so freely in Him, that has been applied to us by Thy Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank Thee for Thy church, first and foremost for this local congregation, O God. We pray for those who are unable to be with us tonight, O God. Please bless them as they continue to work throughout this week and serve Thee. Please bless them in their spiritual disciplines and in their prayers, O Lord, that they might feel Thy presence near to them. Lord, we pray for those who are hurting and sick in our congregation and struggling with besetting sins and other bodily ailments, O God. Lord, please grant them trust and strength and faith in believing, and comfort and assurance in believing by the power of Thy Holy Spirit. Please comfort them and heal their bodily ailments, O Lord, and give them the strength and the endurance and the grace to persevere in difficult times that they might be in. Lord, we pray for the church at large, O God, first in this country and across the whole world, O Lord. Please strengthen her where she is weak. Build her up in the faith once for all delivered unto the saints. And O God, please bring true biblical spirit-wrought revival in our land, O Lord, that every city would fly the flag of Christ Jesus, O Lord, that the Lamb of God, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, would receive the full reward of His sufferings as the elect are brought in, the nations flow in to Zion, O God. Lord, we again thank Thee for this opportunity. We pray for Thy help as we study the life of John Gill, O Lord, that we would be encouraged where he was strong in faith, that we might imitate him as he imitated our Savior, Jesus Christ. And, O Lord, the mistakes that he made, whether it be in theology or other places, O Lord, we would also learn from them, that we might avoid different perils as we study the lives of the saints that have gone before us. Lord, it is with gracious hearts that we thank Thee, and we ask for an increase of Thy Spirit among us, that we might be drawn more closely to our Savior and our Lord, our King, Jesus Christ. It's in His name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I do want to begin by reading Scripture. As you may have heard, we will be doing another biographical sketch this evening on the Baptist John Gill, who lived in the 1700s. But I do want to begin by reading a portion of Scripture. Hebrews chapter 13, we'll begin in verse 7. Hebrews chapter 13, beginning in verse 7. We read in verse 7, "Remember those who rule over you, who have spoken the word of God to you, whose faith follow, considering the outcome of their conduct. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be carried about with various and strange doctrines, for it is good that the heart be established by grace, not with foods which have not profited those who have been occupied with them." This is the word of the Lord. We notice even in those verses, obviously, they're being written to about the pastors that are in their congregation directly, but we can also apply it to studying church history. As we study church history, we see men who have gone before us, who have followed the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are to imitate them and follow them insofar as they follow Jesus Christ. He also mentions about not being carried away with strange doctrines and false doctrines and various doctrines. And the study of church history can definitely help us do that. I believe that the study of Christian biography is an important spiritual discipline. We can learn from those men and women of the faith, whether they were ministers or missionaries or just your average Christians who have gone before us. While we learn most, I think, from those godly persons whose lives are recorded for us in the inspired word, that great cloud of witnesses that the author of Hebrews refers to, we can still, in addition to them, gain much from studying the lives of believers in church history, even if their lives are not recorded for us in Holy Scripture. They have all lived in very different times and different cultures and different places, and they've even believed, some of them, many different things than we might today. Yet all of these saints that we might study from church history all served the same God, and they belong to the same church that we do today. One of these believers whom we wish to study this evening is John Gill. Some of you might have heard of John Gill. Gill lived in a time very different than us, the 1700s, not 2022. He lived in a different place than us, England, and he believed some different things than we do at ROPC. He was a Credo Baptist. He believed in believers' baptism. Still, if we fail to gain anything, any insight or encouragement for our Christian life in studying the life of John Gill, I think the fault is ours. Other great men have also found the study of John Gill's life an encouragement to themselves and in their ministry and in their Christian profession and life. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, another prominent Baptist you might have heard of, while he was in the midst of what was called the downgrade controversy. In that time, in the late 1800s, mid to late 1800s, in the Baptist denominations in England, they were downgrading doctrine. That's why it became known as the downgrade controversy. And many Baptists of that time were abandoning Orthodox Christianity, even calling into question the virgin birth and the deity of Christ. Well, during this time, Charles Haddon Spurgeon faced the real possibility of losing friends, of losing influence, of losing funding for his unflinching adherence to sound doctrine, even in the midst of the church around him going into the gutters as far as doctrine is concerned. He found comfort and resolve by recalling a similar moment in the life of his predecessor, Dr. John Gill. He wrote in a letter to his elders and deacons these words, quote, "I cannot at this present moment tell you what spite has been used against me, or you would wonder indeed, but the love of God first and your love next are my comfort and stay. We may perhaps be made to feel some of the brunt of the battle in our various funds," meaning as we stick strong to Scripture, Spurgeon is saying that our funding might go down. "But the Lord liveth," he continues. "My eminent predecessor, Dr. Gill, was told by a certain member of his congregation, who ought to have known better, that if he published his book, The Cause of God and Truth, he would lose some of his best friends and that his income would fall off. The good doctor said, 'I can afford to be poor, but I cannot afford to injure my conscience or the gospel. And he has left his mantle as well as his chair and our vestry,'" end quote. That's by Spurgeon. So Spurgeon looked to the life of John Gill to find encouragement in the midst of this doctrinal downgrade that was going on around him. Gill is a man whose life is worthy of study and imitation. That is my conclusion after studying his life. After Gill's death, his close friend, who was an Anglican hymn writer and theologian, Augustus Toplady, wrote this, quote, "Such were the indefatigable labors, such the exemplary life, and such the comfortable death of this great and eminent person. If any one man can be supposed to have trod the whole circle of human learning, it was Dr. Gill. His attainments, both in obscure and polite literature, were, which is very uncommon, equally extensive and profound. Providence had, to this end, endued him with a firmness of constitution and an unremitting vigor of mind, which rarely fall to the lot of the sedentary and the learned. It would perhaps try the constitutions of half the literate in England, only to read with care and attention the whole of what he wrote. So Augustus Toplady is saying this man's learning was so exquisite, so extensive, and his labor so intensive and so voluminous that it would actually take the best educated people in England at that time. They probably couldn't even read half of what he wrote in his whole life, more or less everything he read. Like Toplady, who again was an Anglican, we ought to see a man like John Gill, regardless of his denominational associations, regardless also of his idiosyncrasies of some of his beliefs, we should still see him as worthy of imitation in both his character and his doctrine. And hopefully we'll see that by the end of this sketch. Sadly, many even among the Baptist believers, Reformed Baptists included, have shirked away from the study of Gill's life and work. And I think this is due mostly to misunderstanding, misrepresentation on some parts, or just ignorance of who he even was. He's been labeled as a hyper-Calvinist. He's been labeled as an antinomian. He's been labeled a bunch of different things. And though you might be able to make a case that some of that might have some warrant, overall, I think that those are misrepresentations and misunderstandings of Gill's theology and teaching. Over the years, I have been greatly benefited, both in my sanctification and my understanding of the Bible and theology, by the study of Gill's life and writings. And I continue to consult him regularly as I prepare sermons and teachings and in school. And it's my prayer that through this biographical sketch, you also will be engaged to take up and read Gill when you have the chance. And the preparation of this biographical sketch I've benefited from and owe much to the following resources: the Reverend John Rippon's The Life and Writings of John Gill, Tom Nettle's essay on Gill and the Baptists and volume one of his work on the Baptists, Robert W. Oliver's History of the English Calvinistic Baptists from John Gill to C.H. Spurgeon, which is put out by Banner of Truth. That is a very interesting and helpful volume on the history of the Calvinistic Baptists in England. Let's begin with the birth of a Baptist stalwart. John Gill was born at Kettering, Northamptonshire, on the 23rd of November, 1697, so just before the turn of the century, to Edward and Elizabeth Gill. Now, in the providence of God, the Gills were, in the words of Rippon, quote, equally delivered from the snares of poverty and affluence. They were not overly wealthy, but they were also not overly poor. The Gill family spent their days in peaceful industry, he writes, and genuine religion. They were productive people, and they were pious people. John's father, Edward Gill, was a member of the dissenting congregation there in Kettering, which consisted, this is an interesting point, consisted of Presbyterians, Independents, and Baptists who were all seeking to dwell in unity together. So the church there that his father attended, he attended, his family attended, was made up of Presbyterians, Independents, and Baptists all trying to dwell together in unity in the same church. Within this church was a teaching elder by the name of William Wallace, yes, that was his name, who presided as the administrator of baptism by immersion for adult believers who desired it. So they had one ruling elder there in the congregation that would actually administer baptism by profession of faith, credo baptism by immersion, to those who wanted it. So they were kind of trying to satisfy everybody. At some point, the Baptists were compelled to separate from the dissenting congregation and form their own church. So obviously, even though they intended to have this unity, it didn't end up working out. Having formed this new Baptist church, they joined the particular Baptist denomination of the time, with William Wallace residing as their pastor. Now, particular Baptists, what do we mean by that? Well, in that day, there was particular Baptists, and they're to be distinguished from what is called general Baptists. The particular Baptists held that Christ's redemptive work on the cross was particular in its scope. It applied to the elect, and it was only intended for the elect, and it's only effectual for the elect. Whereas the general Baptist believed that Christ's death on the cross was generally for everyone and was subsequently applied to the elect due to their foreseen faith. So Calvinistic is particular Baptist, Arminian is the general Baptist. John's father, Edward Gill, was known for his grace, his piety, and his holiness. He was raised, that is, John Gill was raised in a very godly home. And in fact, Edward Gill, his father, was even elected to the office of deacon in this new church where he served faithfully until his death. Now, as soon as he was able to demonstrate any skills of any kind, John Gill demonstrated an extraordinary capacity for instruction and for learning, which would follow him all the days of his life. He was voracious in reading and learning, and he was good at it. He was soon out of the reach of the common teachers at the school and was sent by his father to the grammar school in town, which he attended with many of the other children of the dissenting families in Kettering. He applied himself to the teaching in that place, in that grammar school, with, quote, uncommon diligence and unwearied application, quickly surpassing those of his own age and even others who were considerably his senior, end quote. He continued in that grammar school until he was 11 years old. During this time, besides going through all of the common school books which were required for them where he was taught, he mastered the principal Latin classics, and he made such a proficiency in the Greek classics as obtained for him marks of distinction from several of the neighboring clergy, who condescended occasionally to examine and encourage his progress when they met him at the bookseller's shop in town, which he constantly attended on market days, end quote. Now, later in life, Gill was forced to offer a defense of his learning in vindication of his work, a dissertation on Jewish proselyte baptism, because he ended up leaving school, as we will see, never to return. So he had to give a defense of his learning, that he was even equipped to write a book like this. He begrudgingly admitted in that work that at 9 years of age, he had mastered Virgil in the original Latin. Gill's thirst for knowledge soon became a proverb in town, actually. This is funny. Whenever someone wished to describe something as being absolutely certain, this will be certain to happen, they would say, the matter is as sure as that John Gill is in the bookseller's shop. Sadly, but in God's good providence, as we mentioned, Gill left school by the age of 11 years old, and he never returned to formal schooling again. This was due to an unfortunate incident. The teacher of the grammar school there in town where he was sent was a member of the established Anglican Church and would require the students under his care, even those of dissenting families, to attend church with him on the weekdays during the hours of prayer. Now, many of the parents, again, who were sending their children to this grammar school were from dissenting families. They didn't belong to the established church of the Anglican Church, the English Church. And they considered this an imposition upon their freedoms and upon their consciences, and so therefore they removed their children from under the teacher's care at that time. Now, our young friend John Gill was among those children who were removed from the school. The affluent families among the dissenters then went and placed their children in other schools to finish their education. However, though the Gills weren't poor, they weren't wealthy enough to actually afford to do this for their son. And they searched in vain for clergy and ministers around the area to finish his education. Though they weren't able to undertake educating John Gill further, these ministers, the local clergy, got together and raised funds, actually, for him to attend one of the seminaries. So while he couldn't go to the next grammar school, they did raise money, hoping that they could at least send him to the seminary for further education. Reverend Ripon writes this, quote, specimens of John's attainments in his learning were sent to the proper persons in town, who replied that John Gill was too young at present to be admitted onto their foundation, and that should he continue to make such rapid advances in his studies, which was a very supposable thing, he would pass through the common circle of learning quite in his juvenile days before it was usual to employ young persons in the sacred service of the sanctuary. This Elizabethan prose is flowery, but all that's really saying is that John was too smart to go to the seminary. He was too smart to go to the seminary because he would finish his studies and be ready to enter the ministry while he was still a juvenile. And they recognized this and said, that's great that you've raised the funds for this young man, but if you send him here, he'll advance so quickly and finish all of his coursework that he'll finish and be ready to go into the ministry, but he'll still be a child. But in spite of these circumstances, the young John not only maintained his knowledge of Latin and Greek on his own at the bookseller's shop and at home, but also incessantly improved himself in both Greek and Latin. And to his extensive knowledge of Latin and Greek, he added logic, rhetoric, and also natural and moral philosophy. Now, possibly most incredibly of all, at the age of 11, John Gill obtained Buxtorf's Hebrew grammar and lexicon, and he taught himself the Hebrew language, quote, without any living assistance, end quote, making such swift advancement in the language that he, quote, could soon read Hebrew with great ease and pleasure, end quote. He's 11. Few Hebrew professors, even in seminaries, can sit down with a Hebrew Bible and read it with ease, and probably with even less measure of pleasure. In fact, at that time, there's some interesting stories in the biography that I did not include of ministers at this time when he's 11, 12, 13 years old, because of his learning in Latin and Greek and Hebrew, the ministers from the surrounding towns would actually come to Gill when they had an exegetical question about Hebrew or Greek, or maybe they wanted to check a comment in a commentary just to double check. Let's go see young Gill. He'll tell us if the exegesis of the Hebrew checks out. John worked with his father in the woolen trade until he was 19 years old. And all of the rest of his time, when he wasn't working, was religiously consecrated to his studies, if I might put it that way. He improved his learning in many aspects of study. He mastered the church fathers in Latin and Greek. So now he had mastered the Greek and Latin classics, Plato and Virgil, etc. And now he went on to master the church fathers in the original Latin and Greek. And he became greatly acquainted with the best authors of foreign divinity that were available in Latin, like Calvin and Turretin and von Maastricht and Polanus. Those names might mean something to some of you, which he frequently alludes to in his later publications in life. So he now has expanded, even though he's not in school, he's taking the opportunity to now learn Hebrew to the point where he can fluently read and with great pleasure and ease read the Hebrew scriptures, and now he's also mastered the church fathers in Latin and Greek, and even now mastered the classic Protestant Reformation Latin works like Calvin and Turretin and von Maastricht. So much for his intellectual life. That's all very impressive, but what about his spiritual life? As a child, John had only slight convictions of the evil of sin, and he rarely thought of a future state at all. Sometimes he was terrified with the fear of death and hell, and at other times he was elated by thinking of the joys of heaven. These thoughts were, however, as Ripon relates, quote, superficial and temporary, till he was about 12 years of age, when the operations of his mind became more serious, end quote. Now, around the age of 12 then, John heard his pastor, William Wallace, preach a sermon on Genesis 3:9, quote, and the Lord called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? For the remainder of his youth, these words from the sermon and from this text, quote, continually sounded in his ears, and these interrogatories were addressed to his heart. He felt like God was speaking to him directly through these words. Sinner, where art thou? What a wretched state and condition art thou in? How miserable wilt thou be, living and dying in an unconverted state? He considered himself as summoned before the judge of all to answer for his conduct, end quote. That's Ripon relating John Gill's thinking at this time. Gill began to be more clearly and frequently seeing the depravity of his nature, the sinfulness of sin, his need of a Savior and of a better righteousness than his own, even the righteousness of Christ to be received by faith. And he was at some point favored with what Ripon calls, quote, a comfortable persuasion of interest in Christ through the application of several exceedingly great and precious promises to his heart by the blessed Spirit of God. It was, moreover, his happy lot in those early days, again, he's around 12 at this time, to have his mind irradiated with the light and knowledge of the evangelical doctrines under the ministry of several gospel preachers. And as these sublime truths came to him, not in word only, but in power, and also in the Holy Ghost, and in much assurance, he felt himself free from the bondage of the law as a covenant of works, and he was filled with joy and peace and believing, end quote. So around the age of 12, he feels that liberty of the gospel come into him through the preaching of the word of God. And he feels that he's no longer simply just terrified of hell or death, or simply just interested in the beauty that is in heaven. But now he feels that these things are his, that Christ belongs to him, and he belongs to Christ. John, however, did not make a public profession of faith until he was almost 19 years old. On November the 1st, 1716, John Gill ended up making a public profession of his faith in Christ, declaring satisfactorily to the church, quote, the dealings of God with his soul. And the same day, Mr. Thomas Wallace, their pastor, administered the ordinance of baptism to him by immersion in a river in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. I put an ellipsis there in my manuscript because Ripon goes on to have a very long discourse on why immersion in a river after professing belief is the right way. He's very incessant upon that, so I spared us that this evening. The following Lord's Day, which was November the 4th, John Gill was received as a member of the church, and then he partook in the Lord's Supper, which was always a great joy to him to partake and to administer the Lord's Supper. He took great delight in it, and it's said of him that when he would administer the supper to the congregation, there was always a great move of the Spirit among them, it seemed. That same evening, Ripon tells us, quote, in a private house, Gill read the 53rd chapter of Isaiah as suitable to the preceding duties of the day, and he expounded some passages of it. Those who were present estimated that the service as a favorable specimen of the ministerial talents the Lord of Zion had conferred upon John. And he was encouraged to proceed in the exercises of his gifts. Accordingly, the next Lord's Day evening, at the same place, he delivered his first discourse on 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and him crucified, end quote. This verse, 1 Corinthians 2:2, you could say, really defines the entirety of Gill's life and ministry from that point forward. It's the first text that he preaches on. He was also a family man. Gill was soon urged by some of his friends in London to move to Hyman Ferrers, which was 6 miles away from where he was in Kettering. He spent some time there studying under the Reverend John Davis, another prominent Baptist, aiding him in discipling and evangelizing the surrounding villages and planting churches and helping out in different ministries there. And while he was here, he met a young lady named Elizabeth Negus, who is a member of Reverend Davis's church. John Gill married her in 1718. And of their marriage, Ripon writes this, quote, his marriage with this excellent person, Elizabeth, he always considered as the principal thing for which God in his providence sent him to that place. For she proved affectionate, discreet, and careful, and by her unremitting prudence, delivered him from all domestic avocations, so that he could, with leisure and greater ease of mind, pursue his studies and devote himself to his ministerial work. I want to make a side comment on that and the providence of God. John Gill considered that the only reason he could really see in the providence of God why God sent him here was that so he could meet his beautiful and helpful and godly wife. And sometimes we are confused as to why it seems that God is moving us in a different direction or moving us to a different place or putting us a different job or a different role. Well, it might be one of the most important things in your life, and it might be a short season, but God might do some of the most important work that he does in your life foundationally and structurally in those short time. So we should always trust ourselves to the providence of God. But it's always easier, as John Flavel, the great Puritan, said about the doctrine of providence. It's like Hebrew letters. It's read backwards. So when we're looking back, we see the providence of God, his hand moving and all sorts of different things. But it's hard to see the time. That's why we have to entrust ourselves to the providence of God here and now. But she proved to be affectionate, discreet, careful. She took care of the home and made sure that he was able to do his duties. She was godly. She assisted him. She prayed for him. All of these things. And I've found it as another side now, it's a temptation of many Reformed men. When we read accounts of these great women standing behind these great men, these great Reformed men and preachers and missionaries in church history, I think it's a temptation for many Reformed men to become critical of their wives or of the future prospects for marriage that they might have. But I think recalling a conversation between a minister and his wife that has been recounted should help to remove the temptation. A minister once told his wife that she should be more like Sarah Edwards. How many of you know who Sarah Edwards was? She was the wife of the great American theologian, Jonathan Edwards, who cared for their many children they had. She managed their homestead to permit Jonathan the time he needed to study and write some of the greatest theological and philosophical works that the world has ever seen, certainly coming out of America. So he said, "You should be more like Sarah Edwards," I think. He said that to his wife. Well, shortly after the minister had said this to his wife pointed to the 26 volumes in the Yale edition of Edwards' writings on the shelves in his study and said, "The day you become like him is the day I'll become like her." All right. Fair enough. Fair enough. Elizabeth Gill stood by John Gill's side for more than 46 years until her death on October 10th, 1764. John delivered her funeral sermon from this text, Hebrews 11:16. "But now they desire a better country, that is, an heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city." So he preaches his own wife's funeral. Ripon tells us that at the close of the manuscript, John Gill's handwritten manuscript, there's an honorable account given of her life from her youth all the way up to her death, where he's praising her and showing all the mighty works of God in her life. But it seems, Ripon writes, that he was so very much overpowered at the end of the sermon, where the account might have been given, that he was not able to deliver it. Hence we see Gill's adoring love and great respect for his wife. She bore him many children. All but three died in infancy, namely Elizabeth, whom Gill described as a most lovely and desirable child for person, sense, and grace. And he said that in her funeral sermon. She died when she was 13. Mary, the other child that survived, who married a bookseller named George Keith, and then he also had a son that he named John, who was to become a goldsmith. All three children, it is reported, were a great happiness to their parents, and the family always had reason to be thankful to God for their domestic comfort, peace, and harmony. Now let's look at him as a pastor and his theological work. Although Gill frequently preached in churches and gatherings around Hyman Ferrers and Kettering, which was mightily blessed of God as he kind of went through an itinerant ministry and where he was invited to preach different places, and he would, he still did not take a pastorate until 1719 when he was 21. After the death of Mr. Benjamin Stinton, and he was the son-in-law of the famous Baptist Benjamin Keach that you might be aware of, who had much to do with the 1689 London Baptist Confession of Faith. Now, members of Stinton's church at Horseleydown, Fair Street, which was a mile from London Bridge, asked Gill to come and preach. Their minister had just died. They asked Gill to come and preach and fill the pulpit for them. He preached there for 2 months, and afterwards, they asked him to remain as their permanent pastor. And on the Lord's Day, September 20th, 1719, he accepted the call to the pastorate of Horseleydown, but he was not ordained until March 22nd, 1720. He remained the pastor of this same church for 51 years. And by all accounts, he was a faithful, concerned, and compassionate pastor, as well as all of the other things that he was. And so he pastors this church for 51 years. Ripon takes over for a number of years. And eventually, Charles Spurgeon takes over that church as well. As a theologian, he is well known. John Gill is known for a few things. He's known for his ability in languages, his abilities in theology and divinity, and his abilities as a preacher and Bible commentator. Some of you might have even have read portions of his Bible commentary. Gill's abilities in Latin, Greek, and Hebrew have already been mentioned, and we took note of the fact that Gill had mastered the essential classics of the Latin and Greek language at a young age, and he had even been able to take great pleasure in reading the Hebrew scriptures since he learned it at the age of 11 by himself. But in 1719, after entering the pastorate, he sought to attain a far more extensive facility in the Hebrew language. And this is important. I'm going to talk about him mastering his Hebrew and filling out his knowledge of Hebrew, because it shows how dedicated he was to rightly understanding, rightly dividing, and rightly proclaiming the Word of God. The Reverend John Skepp was a pastor of the Baptist Church in Cripplegate, London, and he died that year. He left behind a large library of Hebrew literature. Now, prior to his acquaintance with Reverend Skepp, Gill really didn't see the use for rabbinical writings in the Hebrew language. He didn't see any use for rabbinical literature, and that stuff was only at that time especially accessible to those who had a knowledge of Hebrew. But after he spent time talking with Reverend Skepp, Gill was able to come to see that there was a great usefulness for him, at least, in theology and exegesis and studying this rabbinical literature. After Skepp's death, Gill purchased most of his Hebrew and rabbinical books, and he actually then bought more books from a rabbi that he became friends with, a Jewish rabbi they'd become acquainted with. And he set out to study these writings and give himself to the thorough mastery of these rabbinical Jewish writings, like the Mishnah, the Talmuds, the Raboth, the commentaries they'd written, the Targums, and the Book of Zohar, whatever else that they had written that he had access to help him better understand the world of the New Testament, the customs, the language of the New Testament. So he spent all this time, obviously he was gifted in Hebrew, but he spent all of this time studying the Hebrew literature of the rabbis and the Jews to better understand the New Testament. That's how committed he was. John Gill was made a Doctor of Divinity by the University of Aberdeen in 1748 on account of his knowledge of, primarily his knowledge of the Semitic languages and of Jewish antiquities. The funny part is that this honorary doctorate was given to him. It was done without Gill's knowledge. And on one occasion, he meets some deacons from another church in London, and he's passing by them. They begin talking on the street, and they say, "Dr. Gill, we congratulate you for the respect that was shown you by the University of Aberdeen in giving you this honorary doctorate." To which, after thanking them, Gill pleasantly responded, "I neither thought it, nor bought it, nor sought it." So even though he wasn't trying to attain any letters for himself, people recognized widely how brilliant he was and how dedicated he was to the study of Scripture. In 1767, Dr. Gill published a work titled A Dissertation Concerning the Antiquity of the Hebrew Language, Letters, Vowels, Points, and Accents. And he actually published this work to answer the assaults, and these assaults continue to our day, of higher critics who study the Old Testament, higher critics, not lower critics, higher critics who study the Old Testament and try to cast doubt on the authenticity, on the authority and inspiration of the Old Testament. They basically suggest, and they were at this time, this is when this argument's first coming out, that the language, the Hebrew language of the Bible that we have now didn't exist in antiquity. It only came around in the 12th century, and so therefore we can't trust this writing. We can't trust this document. We can't trust the Old Testament, and especially can't trust the doctrine that's espoused in it. If the Hebrew Bible, as we have it at that time, could not have existed even before the 12th century, then the religion it teaches also cannot be considered to be original. Now, had Gill never written anything else, this work alone would prove Gill to be a prodigy of immeasurable proportions. And yet his biographer says this about this work. This work is still studied today, is still considered to be a classic on the Hebrew language. Yet his biographer tells us that this work was written by Gill, quote, "in his leisure hours, for his own amusement, not with any design at first to publish it to the world, but by way of essay to try how far back the antiquity of things treated of it could be carried." He just wanted to see for himself if he could prove this thesis to himself. This same year, Dr. Gill also collated various passages of the Old Testament that were quoted in the Mishnah, the Talmud, the Raboth, and the Midrash, and collated them with the quotations of the Old Testament in the Jewish literature and put them against how they appear in the Hebrew text itself. And this work was also greatly praised and went on to show the authenticity of the readings of the Hebrew Bible. Now, John Gill was also an apologist, and he spent much time in polemical writing against certain errors in his day. Concerning Gill's defense of Orthodox Christianity, Augustus Toplady, again an Anglican, not a Baptist, wrote, quote, "It may be well said of my learned friend, as it was of the Duke of Marlborough, that he never fought a battle which he did not win, end quote. Much of Gill's work consisted of a tireless defense of orthodoxy. Many of his published works consist of simply repackaged sermons that were originally given to build up and edify the saints in his church on the Lord's Day, which he then repackaged, reworked to defend the faith against the opponents of his day. Although Gill responded to many controversies during his day, we spoke a little bit about the Hebrew vowel points and the Hebrew language and the authenticity of the Hebrew language and the Hebrew Bible, there were other things that he gave greater attention to, namely the doctrines of grace or Calvinism, baptism, antinomianism, and the Trinity. He was a stalwart defender of all of those doctrines, and he rightfully saw these as the most important issues of his day. Dr. Gill was not afraid of disagreements and controversies at all. He was, however, afraid of doing dishonor to God's word. At an ordination sermon for the Reverend George Braithwaite in 1734, Gill asserted this in the sermon that he gave, quote, that the minister of the gospel ought to study the scriptures and learn the doctrines of grace as to be assured of them, to be at a point, at a certainty concerning them. A minister should adhere to them, abide by them, and continue in them, even though the majority may be against them, end quote. For Gill, truth does not conform itself to the majority opinion, and it is not to be determined by the number of people who adhere to it. Gill is worthy of imitation in this as well. Regardless of what other people might be saying, regardless of what might be popular in the Reformed world at large, we are to hold to what the Scriptures say and nothing else. Gill ministered in London at a time when Orthodox Christianity was being questioned. One anonymous writer in 1732 described the religious culture this way. Unorthodoxy is very often first manifested in the attacking of the divine decrees by applauding the doctrine of universal redemption as a sentiment that is full of benevolence. So what that means is that the unorthodoxy first appears by saying that the doctrine of Calvinism, that God elects and chooses and is particular in his redemption and application thereof, goes against the benevolence of God, the love of God. So unorthodoxy starts there. And from thence, they appear fond of pleading the cause of the heathens and of the possibility of salvation merely by the light of nature and sincere improvement of the powers and faculties of man. And by degrees, these charitable sentiments produce a small opinion of revelation and of the necessity of it in order to salvation. No wonder now we see skeptics amongst these truths aforementioned. Also, the doctrine of the Trinity is a matter of jest and ridicule. So this author is saying that at that time, it first started off by people saying that Calvinism, the doctrines of grace, were harsh. They were mean. They went against and rubbed against what appeared to be the benevolence and love of God. And because of that, they then say, well, this charity, they're calling it loosely, then goes on to say, well, people can be saved all sorts of different ways. You don't have to be exclusively a Christian. Thinking of God's doctrine as harsh led them to thinking of God's word as harsh. And before they knew it, they were calling into question not just Calvinism, but even the Trinity and the deity of Christ. Well, Gill would call neither God nor his word harsh. Gill attributed the decline of godliness and piety in his day to a decline not just of sound doctrine in general, but he pinpointed it on a decline in the propagation and teaching and delighting in the doctrine of God's sovereign grace in particular. He really saw this as the issue of the day, that the reason the churches were declining in godliness and in growth and in piety was because people were no longer believing in or teaching the doctrines of grace. Tom Nettles writes this, quote, Gill was convinced that a firm grasp of these truths would enhance morality and virtue, which cannot exist apart from internal holiness, end quote. So for Gill, those who best understood the doctrines of grace, Calvinism, would be the ones who would live the most consistently holy and peaceable lives. And I think that is still true, even though we see oftentimes those who hold to the doctrines of grace, myself included, I've done this before, actually be the ones who are the least gracious in their holding to it. For Gill, It was, in fact, only those who truly treasure the righteousness of Christ, to see it as their own, by grace through faith, the sovereign grace of God applied to them, who have a high enough view of God's law to live according to it in obedience to God. Free and sovereign grace, according to Gill, does not lead to free and unholy living. Well, God has given me free grace, so I'll just live however I want. Rather, he argued that it was just the opposite. The more one understands God's free, sovereign, electing love, the more they will be united to him in character, in holiness, and affection. Gill rightly connected sound doctrine and sound living. And we need to see more of that, I think, as Calvinists and Reformed people specifically. Around 1733, the Arminian theologian Dr. Whitby published a discourse on the five points. Now, this came out as an attack against the five points of Calvinism. It was considered a masterpiece on the subject in the English language, even right when it first came out, and it was judged as, quote-unquote, unanswerable by Calvinists. It was the supposed nail in the coffin of Calvinism. Almost every opponent, therefore, of Calvinism started ganging up on John Gill specifically. And they asked him, Why do you not answer Dr. Whitby? Why are you afraid to answer him? Well, Gill, feeling induced by everyone ganging up on him and saying that this is unanswerable, decided to give it another reading, and he felt that he was inclined to answer it. So in 1735 and the three following years, he ended up publishing one of his most famous works called The Cause of God and Truth. The Cause of God and Truth, and it's in four volumes. You can still purchase it or read it today. This work is made up of four separate parts. In part one, he gives an answer to 60 passages of Scripture, which Whitby and other Arminians of the time had said demonstrate that Calvinism is at odds with the Bible. In part two, he gives a positive presentation of 62 other passages, which he says systematically present Calvinism from the Bible. Part three gives a defense of the doctrines of grace historically from Reformed authors and from the Holy Scriptures in response to Whitby's objections against them. And part four, this is probably the most interesting part of the whole work, consists of an array of pre-Augustinian patristic citations. Gill went to the early church fathers pre-Augustine and collected writings and quotations from them that he felt supported the Calvinist position. So, he said that while they don't give as distinct and coherent of an argument as that of Augustine, his main goal was to show that the Arminians were wrong in using them. They don't actually support their theory that the patristic authors didn't teach Calvinism. Calvinism was as old as the Bible, is his goal in writing this work. Now, this great work issued from the press at a time when England was generally alarmed with the growth of Roman Catholicism. Roman Catholicism is growing again in England. And at that time, there were some ministers who were writing and preaching against the distinguishing tenets and doctrines of Roman Catholicism, which they called popery. But Gill felt that they missed the mark. He felt they missed the mark. The root issue of why people were beginning to accept Roman Catholicism was left untouched. Gill believed, that the increase of Roman Catholic converts in England was primarily owing to Arminianism and other rational schemes that were opposed to divine revelation. Therefore, Gill proposed, rather than chopping away at, quote, the branches of popery, the axe should be laid at the root of the tree, namely Arminianism and Pelagianism, which are the very life and soul of popery, end quote. Gill remains one of the greatest defenders of the Calvinistic system to date, rightly seeing the defense of the doctrines of grace as essential to the defense and health of Christianity. Preacher of the Word. Gill perhaps is best known today for his exposition of the Old and New Testaments, which is available for free online, a number of websites you can read it, probably on your phone you have it, as well as in PDF and print formats. It's widely used, even today, possibly only being surpassed in English readership by Matthew Henry's commentary. And he had a lectureship that he partook on, a Wednesday night lectureship that he partook in with some other ministers in the area that he did for 26 years, where he taught through books of the Bible consecutively in these Wednesday night lectures. And it's from this as well as his other Sunday morning and Sunday evening lectures, his Lord's Day work as well as his midweek work and his other preaching endeavors that really form the basis of his massive commentary on the entirety of the Old Testament and New Testament. For what it's worth, and I think it's worth much, Spurgeon held John Gill as a commentator highly. He highly prized John Gill's commentary. And he said, "Probably no man since Gill's day has at all equaled him in the matter of rabbinical learning. For good, sound, massive, sober sense and commenting, who can excel Gill?" He then goes on to give a couple critiques that sometimes when he comes to a passage, this is Spurgeon speaking about Gill, sometimes when Gill comes to a passage that he doesn't feel jives with his theological system, he'll hack away at it to try to make it fit in, Spurgeon says. So that might be something that you want to look out for. Also, he is called a hyper-Calvinist, and Spurgeon addresses that very thing. He says he's been called the father of hyper-Calvinism, but if his followers never went beyond their master, they would not go very far astray, end quote. So you do want to be careful when reading any commentary, any theologian. They are not the Word of God. The Word of God is the Word of God. The Bible is our final authority. But we can still learn great things from men who have gone before us and have studied these things and written down their thoughts for us. He published the work through 1757 is when he began publishing his work on the Old and New Testament, his exposition. And by 1758, he had finished the prophets, the larger and the shorter prophets. And he had also given an introduction to prophecy and a writing on the apocryphal writings as well in there. And by 1761, he had finished the entirety of the Old Testament from Genesis to Solomon's Song. And by 1766, he had finished the New Testament as well. So in total, it's 9 volumes, 6 on the Old, 3 on the New. So how could he have, in less than 10 years, finished this massive writing? Well, Spurgeon says that Gill was always at work. "It's difficult to say when he slept," Spurgeon wrote, "for he wrote 10,000 folio pages of theology," end quote. Now, we can rightly ask, I think, at this point, how did John Gill accomplish such a task? How could any one man perform all of this labor? This is common with a lot of the people we study from church history. Thankfully, we have an answer. It should be obvious that it would have been, by natural standards, impossible for anyone to have done this if they didn't have some sort of system, if they didn't have a plan in place, without method, unremitting exertion, and cheerful perseverance, Ripon says. It must be remembered that Dr. John Gill was quite literally never tired of reading. He was never tired of writing. He was never tired of study. He was never tired of preaching. His meat and drink were to know God's will and to do it. Now, just because most of us aren't ministers of the gospel, most of us aren't preaching, doesn't mean we can't give ourselves the same tireless exertion and cheerful perseverance to all the things that God calls us to in our own lives as well. You don't have to be a minister of the gospel specifically and only to give yourself to God and his labors in that way. We can do that in whatever calling God has us. He was aptly nicknamed even in his own time. He wrote 10,000 folio pages of theology, Spurgeon mentions, and he was aptly nicknamed Dr. Voluminous even in his own day. And indeed, it would likely take a lifetime to read everything that came from his pen. I have a lot of it, but I don't have everything, and I certainly haven't read all of it. Of just his major popular works, the ones that still can be purchased, we have around 12,123 pages in small print, and most of it double column small print. So basically, you can double that amount of pages. This would include his exposition of the Old and New Testaments, his exposition of Solomon's Song, his 4-volume defense of Calvinism called The Cause of God and Truth, and his collected 6 volumes of sermons and tracts. He also wrote a systematic theology. It's a systematic theology, a body of practical and doctrinal divinity. So how we are to believe and how we are to live. It's actually very wonderful. I'm working with it currently, and writing a paper on baptism where I'm interacting with him as my interlocutor. His character. I want to finish by looking at his character and why we should imitate him and what we should imitate about him. In the last section of this biographical sketch, we'll be looking at his character as a friend and as a Christian. We have some revealing comments about John Gill by those who knew him as a friend, which will give us some insight into his heart and in his thought and in his Christian character. I can only quote one of them for time. John Rippon recounts his Catholicity and his cheerfulness and disagreement like this by telling us this information. Quote, "In the midst of John Gill's days, it was his practice once a week to meet his ministering brethren at their accustomed coffee house, or else to spend a friendly hour with them under the hospitable roof of Thomas Watson, an honored member of the Baptist Church, then meeting at Cripplegate. That gentleman kept an open table on Tuesdays for the dissenting ministers of three differing denominations. The doctor generally met with them, took his part cheerfully in conversation with the brethren present, and he maintained it on their return home, whether they came back on foot or by boat, as they now and then did. Coming back one day by boat, an excellent minister of the independent denomination, of whom Dr. Gill was particularly fond, said to him, when there was a great swell of the tide and some of the gentlemen were uneasy in the boat, 'Ah, doctor, you don't fear. You love much water,'" poking fun at John Gill being a Credo Baptist who believed in immersion. "Yes," he replied, "I do love much water in its proper place, and I love you too. But, Brother Bentley, a little water in a barber's basin is enough for some people," poking fun at his being a Pado Baptist. "You know what I mean, brother?" "Yes," said Bentley in good humor, "I do." All smiled. The banter was quite in the spirit of genuine friendship, and it was natural for one of them, when they were gone ashore and parting quite in a fraternal way, to say, "Well, doctor, much water, however, has done no one of us any harm." "True," said John Gill, "and we are all sure that sprinkling alone would never have brought us safe to shore." So you can see that he spent time ministering and feasting and eating and speaking and with all these other ministers in the area, and they could poke fun at each other, and they could write serious volumes of work in defense of their beliefs, but they could also spend time encouraging one another and praying for one another and joking with one another. As a Christian, a person's last words often give us an insight into their overall character, and especially their spiritual character. Rippon tells us that in his last letter, shortly before his death, John Gill wrote, quote, "I depend wholly and alone upon the free, sovereign, eternal, unchangeable love of God, the firm and everlasting covenant of grace, and my interest in the persons of the Trinity, for my whole salvation, and not upon any righteousness of my own, nor on anything in me, or done by under the influences of the Holy Spirit, not upon any services of mine, which I have been assisted to perform for the good of the church, do I depend. Anything I've done for the church, anything that the Holy Spirit has enabled me to do, I don't depend on any of those even. But upon my interest in the persons of the Trinity alone do I depend. The free grace of God and the blessings of grace streaming to me through the blood and righteousness of Christ as the ground alone of my hope. These are no new things to me, but what I have been long acquainted with all of my days, what I can live and die by. I apprehend I shall not be here long, but this you tell to all and any of my friends." End quote. His dying state, when he actually came to die, was prolonged, it was very gradual, and it was frequently attended with intense and violent pains in his stomach, as well as a loss of appetite. Quote, "But he bore the visitation of his heavenly Father," that's how he viewed it, his heavenly Father visiting him, "with patient composure and sweet resignation to the divine will, never uttering a single complaint," end quote. Well, I could certainly imitate him in that, couldn't I? The peacefulness of his soul, his internal joy he had in Christ, and his assurance of salvation, even in the darkest times, even the most painful times as he came to die, never left him. Quote, "The last words he was ever heard to speak were, 'Oh, my Father, my Father.' And thus he gloriously terminated his mortal career without a sigh or a groan on the 14th day of October, 1771, at about 11 o'clock in the forenoon, at his house in Chamberwell, Surrey, aged 73 years, 10 months, and 10 days. So should we follow John Gill? My answer to that question is yes. I think there's three aspects specifically that Gill is worthy of careful and prayerful imitation. As a student of the Word, John Gill was tireless in his pursuit of truth. Truth that's founded upon the revealed Word of God. God's inspired, inerrant, infallible Word. He was given to constant and cheerful examination of God's Word. Though he had all of this other learning, all of it was employed. All of it was intended simply to know God's Word better, not just as a preacher, but for himself. He was not content with misunderstanding portions of the Bible or leaving them not thoroughly examined. Though we may differ with him on some of his conclusions in his study, I think we can definitely learn much from his diligence in searching out the truth. Like Charles Spurgeon, who came after him, said that we should visit many books, but we should live in one book, the Bible. I almost pointed to our hymnal. Not that one. This one. As a defender of the Word, we can also follow him. John Gill never backed down from the truth, regardless of what it cost him. If it cost him finances, friends, whatever it might be, he didn't back down. He stood for the Word of God. He stood for truth. He lovingly and fairly defended what he believed the Scriptures taught. In fact, he has a book that I once read, which is called Infant Baptism, a Part and Pillar of Popery. So very offensive to us as Presbyterians and to myself now as a Paedo-Baptist. But even in that book, he's very ironic. He's speaking as to brothers. He's asserting that he thinks this is a Roman Catholic heresy to baptize our children. And he won't back down from that. But his tone, the way he does it, and he even says in the preface that I'm writing to brothers, that I'm writing to people that I love and I know love Christ's church and love Christ's word, and I'm appealing to our common love to Christ. He was wrong, but he was right in his love for his brethren and for the truth, even though he was wrong about what he thought the truth was. He knew that right understanding leads to right living. And out of love to God and out of love to fellow man, he always sought to correctly understand and faithfully defend what he believed the Scriptures taught. And as we saw earlier in his joking with his Paedo-Baptist friends, he was able to cheerfully disagree with others without backing down from the truth. Without backing down from the truth. Our loving our fellow Christians does not require us to be soft or gushy on what we believe or to water down what we believe. We can manfully hold to what we believe the Scriptures teach while yet being loving to our brothers who disagree with us. I know many of us at this church especially know that. As a man of focus and discipline, we can also imitate him. John Gill gave all of his energy and his labors to achieving his goals. He committed his ways and his works to the Lord his God. And again, this applies to all of us, whether we're a minister or not. Whatever we do, we must do it unto the Lord. We must seek to glorify and honor God in all that we do. We must commit our ways to him. He didn't let anything get in the way of this. You know, maybe he was too focused, some would say, to his work. But he certainly serves as a rebuke for lackadaisical theologizing that we see so much of in our generation today. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God Almighty, we again thank thee for this opportunity to read thy word. At the beginning, in Hebrews, where we read to study those who have gone before us, how we might learn from their lives, their devotion to thee, their love of the Savior Jesus Christ. And as we studied a man that we disagree with on some very important things, John Gill, Lord, help us to take away from his life those good things that he imitated Christ in. Let us be imitators of Christ as we imitate John Gill. Oh Lord, give us a love for thy word that we see in John Gill. Give us a love for thy people and thy church that we see in John Gill. And help us, oh Lord, to be diligent in our studies, and diligently set our hands to the work which thou hast given to each one of us. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.